to a special edition of Medicine of Meadville. I'm Dwayne Kohler from Meadville Medical Center. And we have a lot of things going on today. We're going to talk about WIC, and we're going to talk with folks from the Erie Center for Children and Adults. So a lot of things involving kids and health involved. So I'm really curious to learn a lot more today. So I think you will be too. So stay tuned. Joining us now, Carrie Dinsmore from WIC. Carrie, welcome to Medicine of Meadville for your first time.
Thank you.
So we want to meet you first, but tell us what WIC is. Assume someone's never heard of it. What's WIC?
Okay. So WIC stands for Women, Infants, and Children, and it is a supplemental nutrition program that benefits moms and their children, especially during pregnancy and the first 5 years of life for a child.
So tell us about you. Tell us about your training and your story and how you got to WIC.
Sure. So I started with the WIC program in 2003. I worked for the WIC program as a nutritionist in our Warren County office, and I was up there for about 2 years, and then I worked here for a year, and then also at the same time for the Erie County WIC program. Then I had a few years where I went into various management jobs in long-term care, and then most recently I was in the early childhood world as an executive director of a nonprofit child care center. And when Lori D'Arcangelo retired in June, I came back to WIC as the director. So I've been back on board since August officially.
So kids and nutrition, those things all sound like they were in there a lot. So those are things that you have a lot of interest in and a lot of experience with. So.
Yes.
So on the picture, there's a new logo there that I don't remember that logo before. Is that new? That's pretty impressive.
Yes, this is the new Pennsylvania WIC logo. And what I like about it is that it's kind of updated. And it depicts the mom, the child, and the infant. But it's just a nice representation of the program. It's a simple representation of the program. It's moms, babies, their children's, and the apple, of course, resembles nutrition, and it's just kind of got a modern appeal to it.
I was just going to ask you about that. So we got mom, she's pregnant, obviously. We got a baby there, and then we got, looks like a six-year-old or a five-year-old or whatever there. He's eating a nutritious apple. So the apple a day keeps the doctor away, that whole thing, right?
Yep.
So let's start with mom. So what kind of things, if you know, first visit, someone's coming to you and they're expecting and whatever, what kind of stuff do you tell them?
Right. So we do what's called a diet questionnaire to kind of get started. First, we have to make sure that you're income eligible for the program, but a lot of working families in the area do qualify for that. But we'll do a diet questionnaire and we'll kind of get to know you and see how your eating habits are. We'll ask about your medical history and see if there's anything that maybe we could help with in terms of from a nutritional standpoint. And then we'll check your weight and we'll help you monitor your weight gain during your pregnancy. We'll help you make healthy eating choices during your pregnancy. And we'll also provide you with breastfeeding counseling if that's something that you're interested in preparing you for delivery and feeding your baby and those sorts of good things.
So just kind of generally, but what kind of things do I need to stop doing eating-wise and what kind of things do I need to start doing eating-wise during a pregnancy?
Well, a lot of times moms just simply maybe don't eat enough meals, especially if maybe mom has a couple other kids at home and she's busy running around. Sometimes we're the ones that are eating the snack foods and not necessarily taking the time to have a good meal. So we can help with tips on that and kind of maybe even doing smaller, more frequent meals throughout the day. If you smoke, we'll help counsel you on quitting smoking. If there's any other, habits that might pop up, we could help counsel with that as well. And especially one of the key nutrients that we focus on is iron, your B vitamins, your folic acid, things that are very, very important during your pregnancy for proper fetal growth.
Are those things supplements or are those things I'm looking for foods that have those things in them?
A lot of times we can find them just in the foods in our grocery store. And so a lot of the foods that we do provide have those nutrients within them.
So let me ask you a hard question. Actually, this is an easy question. Okay. So when I go to the grocery store, how do I know which one to pick?
Okay. So when you come into WIC, part of the program is we give you food vouchers. And those vouchers are just like checks. And they'll have a prescribed food package for you on there. And there might be so many ounces of cereal and so many gallons of milk and beans and different foods, vegetables and fruits. We have a food list here. I'm not sure if we can get that in the camera. But every year we put out a new food list, and these are the foods that are WIC approved. So when you go to the grocery store, you can pick from these foods according to your checks and pick those foods out in the grocery store. So for example, there's a ton of cereals that have the proper amounts of iron and folic acid in them, and those have already been predetermined by the state agency nutritionist in terms of what can be purchased. So just by following the food package, you're going to be getting the right nutrients
to help your diet. I see Wheaties on there.
Yeah.
I see Chex. I see things that aren't mm-hmm. uncommon. You know,
yeah.
I don't see like all the sugary ones.
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
No, sugar has to be somewhat limited. We're looking for whole grains, a limit on the sugars, but a lot of cereals now. You do see more focus on the whole grains and less sugar and that sort of thing. So there's actually quite a good variety there that are common cereals that you might be purchasing without even knowing that they're really good for you.
Okay. Okay, so now the things that we're picking for mom, also that's going to apply for kids too?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are they marked? Do the packages have a mark on them, or does the grocery store have an indication?
Yes. So the next time you're in the grocery store, if you look at the shelf tags, a lot of times you'll see a bright yellow tag and it'll say WIC approved. So the next time you're in the bread aisle, you're in the cereal aisle, the rice aisle, you'll see the WIC approved logos right there. And then you would just look at your check and make sure that you're buying the right ounce box to match.
Oh, okay. Right? Okay. So in addition to the right one, mm-hmm. I'm looking for certain sizes.
Yeah.
And okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we can help you figure out those ounces and that sort of thing, because like for example, a pregnant mom might have 36 ounces of cereal on her check, so she could buy 2 18-ounce boxes of cereal, or she could buy 3 12-ounce boxes of cereal.
Okay.
So you got to do a little math.
Okay. So Carrie, on the logo, I mean the little guy's holding an apple there, so fresh versus processed, how do I know what's going to be the best, you know, a for me and for the kids?
Right. So when you come into WIC, your WIC nutritionist is going to go over the checks that you would be getting for your child, and a lot of times the children's checks are a smaller version of what the parent is getting, the mom's getting on her checks. So a lot of times fresh fruits and vegetables are on there. That gives you an opportunity to go out and purchase carrots, celery, green peppers, apples, oranges, grapes, things that kids like that sometimes as parents we don't necessarily purchase all the time because they are typically at a higher expense. So by having that fruit and vegetable voucher option, parents have the option of getting that in addition for their kids. So circling back to, you know, the program and how it's changed over the years, juice used to be the only fruit and vegetable that was given on the checks. And juice is good, but once your vitamin C is met for the day, you know, all that extra juice can be metabolized as sugar. And when we give all of that juice at one time on a check, parents didn't necessarily have the ability to stop their kids from drinking all that juice, you know, maybe within a week. So by giving the fruit and vegetables, that gives kids an opportunity to try some fresh fruits and vegetables, get more fresh fruits and vegetables into their diet, but also kind of limit the juice because that has been found to just have the extra sugar, even though it's good for you.
So is there some sort of a guide or some sort of a checklist or something that, that maybe mom has to take mm-hmm. with her when she's picking?
Yes. So we have a smaller version of this poster, and these are what your checks are put into. This is a food list, and it goes through each of the food categories that we have. So milk, it'll go through the different varieties of milk that's available, different varieties of yogurt that's available, different varieties of produce that's available, soy products if you're approved to get soy. So that's an important note. Kids that have a milk allergy or lactose intolerance, they could get a soy product in replacement. We would work with a pediatrician to approve that. Again, we still give juice. It's just that the quantity is not as high as it used to be. And the fresh fruits and vegetables, a lot of options on there. So blueberries and strawberries and bananas. And your cereals, like we said, there's a ton on there that are approved. So you can go through these lists and know ahead of time, you know, you're going to know if you're getting milk and cheese and how much ounces of cereal you're getting. And then you would just follow the food list and try, you know, as you would go through a shopping experience, you are picking out things that you like. Another neat thing with WIC is that you can use coupons with your WIC checks because it's just like cash. So if you had a buy one, get one free coupon and you were purchasing the item with your WIC, then you would get that second item for free.
Oh, okay, yeah. Very good. Mm-hmm. So now I don't want to get us off track here, but so the rules have changed for the guidelines for juice and so, you know, mm-hmm. what happens behind the scenes to decide that? How what's that process like?
Oh, geez. Well, we're not necessarily involved in that process, but there is a nutritionist at the state and they have a committee and they review foods and they take recommendations and, you know, those sorts of things.
So this isn't something that's written in stone forever and ever and ever, whenever some new research comes out.
Right. And it's also important to note that, so this might be the Pennsylvania State WIC program. It's actually a USDA-funded program. So a lot of these guidelines come down from the USDA. So that money funnels into the state, and the state distributes the funds to programs like us. We're with Community Health Services, and we're administering the WIC program on the state's behalf.
Sure. What's the USDA again?
United States Department of Agriculture.
I should know that. Yeah. Okay. My brain was thinking FDA. So that's not right. Okay.
Food Drug Administration.
Okay.
Yeah.
So WIC also gets involved with breastfeeding and nursing. Talk about that for a second. I know there's a big event, that's happened a while ago.
But. Yes. Every August for the last 5 years, we've been doing what's called the Big Latch On. And this year, we had that, well, actually the last 2 years at Roach Park, because the event kind of has been growing each year. But basically, it's a worldwide breastfeeding event where moms nurse for a minute, everybody together. And those total counts of breastfeeding are calculated, and there's a goal that's set every year. So I'm actually not sure what the numbers are, but I know that we had, I think, around 50 some moms.
So let's take a step back. So baby formula, nursing, which better?
Okay, so we are huge supporters of breastfeeding. We believe breastfeeding is best. However, we do have infant formula available because sometimes that is not mom's preference. Sometimes it might be a foster child situation. Sometimes there might be a medical reason why mom cannot breastfeed. So we do offer infant formula as well.
Okay.
And I think it's important to note, because WIC is a nutrition supplement program, we don't always give the full amount that the baby's going to need. So a lot of times moms will come to WIC expecting WIC to provide the full amount of formula that they need, only to find out that it's not enough for the baby. So that's another reason why we do encourage breastfeeding as well, is just because that is always available. It's the healthiest option for babies and for moms. There's huge benefits for mom and baby with breastfeeding in terms of bonding and mom's postpartum weight loss and the baby's nutrition and, your immunities, antibodies are passed through to the baby from mom. So that's another huge important thing that we really help moms with. And another interesting part of the WIC program is that our program has what's called breastfeeding peer counselors in addition to our nutritionist. So moms that are working with a peer counselor get one-on-one support for their breastfeeding for free. So if they're participating in the program, it's like having a buddy available to you to help you with any problems that might pop up.
So my kids are now in their mid and later 20s, and I remember going to that to that prenatal class with my wife, and nurse after, you know, that's going to help you lose that baby, you know, that baby weight, and it really did. The things you just said were there. I remember that from that long ago, that helps the baby's immune system, you know, and the whole bonding thing and all that. Yeah, and I agree from experience side, not me personally, from my wife and my two daughters, but. Yeah. So those are good things. Mm-hmm. So in general, how do people react to that? I'm so busy. I don't know if I have a time for it. Do you hear things like that?
So we have a slight counseling process that we follow. So when mom's coming in and she's pregnant, we're going to put the bug in her ear. You know, have you thought about breastfeeding? You're definitely interested. Let me talk to you about that. Everybody has a different approach, and I think you kind of pick up those skills with time, and our peer counselors are very good about kind of picking up on people's willingness and receptiveness to the idea. I think some moms come in and they say, yes, I want to breastfeed, and this is what I'm doing, and I know that I'm going to do it. They're very easy to counsel. Some moms maybe are not interested in it, maybe weren't nursed themselves, maybe formula fed a previous baby. There's all kinds of barriers that sometimes we're not even aware of. So it is a sensitive topic to discuss. And so we kind of do a little bit of a question type setting where we can kind of feel somebody out and see where they're at in terms of willingness to at least listen to us about it. And if moms are, I don't want to do that, that's not what I'm interested in, then we're not going to push the subject with you either, because, you know, really it's about us supporting mom, baby, and nutrition for the child and the rest of the family.
I remember at the hospital still when long, long ago, but it's like it didn't work perfectly the first second we tried it, and it's like, oh, stress. But it worked like the next time, everything was fine.
Yeah. And women will have different experiences over multiple pregnancies. Some will have a challenge with one and a breeze with the second, or vice versa. So what's nice is that the peer counselors, if you're on the program when you start, they're going to make that contact with you right away. And they do follow up with you the first 6 weeks after the baby's born. Every week, and you can call them. We have cell phones. They can text a peer counselor after hours if it was an emergency. And depending on the situation, sometimes the peer counselor is able to get right back in touch with that mom. Maybe that minute, maybe in an hour, maybe the next day. So it's a nice support system for moms.
So shift gears for a second, kind of a big point here. But okay, found out that we're pregnant for the first time or whatever. How does someone learn about WIC? What's their introduction? How do you first get with them?
Right. So we have I think a stereotype that we kind of battle in the WIC world because it is something that's given to families at no cost. Unfortunately, I think there's a stigma that sometimes WIC is welfare, and it's not welfare. Our guidelines are significantly higher than what the welfare income guidelines would be. So a lot of working families qualify for WIC and don't even realize that they qualify for WIC. So part of our work is, one, outreach. We need to put the information into the community about what WIC is. We hope that our doctor's offices and pediatrician offices are also pushing WIC, but a lot of times it is word of mouth that people know about WIC. So that's another reason why we're doing this show today, is also just to kind of get the word out there again. But once somebody does know about WIC, they can go online actually and start the application process.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's statewide. So they could have moved here from State College, they could have moved from Philadelphia, they could have moved from anywhere in Pennsylvania, and apply on this website, and whatever agency is closest gets the application.
So the physical location here in Terre Street, but maybe tell folks how to find here and other places nearby.
Right. So if you were to go on to www.pawic.com, meadville.com, you can search for WIC offices within a radius of where you currently are. We are kind of geographically challenged in terms of our rural counties. So in Crawford County, we are the WIC office. We're the only WIC office here. We have a satellite clinic that we do once a month in Titusville. Okay. And then we also have a clinic in Warren County, and we have a clinic in Clarion County. So for our agency, those are our clinics. So if you're in those areas, you are kind of limited to where the WIC office is, which is kind of a struggle, and we're looking at ways to kind of service more of the counties. But you are welcome to attend any WIC clinic in Pennsylvania, regardless of where you live.
So in Meadville, 747 Terra Street. I
always remember that number. 747 Terra Street,
yes. Reminds me of an airplane, 747 Terra Street.
But, for example, if I worked in Erie, I could use the Erie WIC program, even though I live here in Meadville. So we do have some families that do that as well. But yeah, www.pawic.com is where you can search for WIC offices in Pennsylvania.
So did we miss anything? Other points we want to get out there to folks?
There is a 1-800-WIC number, and if you also call 1-800-WIC-WINS, that will also direct you to a WIC clinic in your area.
Okay.
So, and a lot of times.
You put in your zip code or something? And
I'm not actually sure. I've never used it, but the phone goes directly to that WIC clinic.
1-800-WIC-WINS.
WIC-WINS.
W-I-C-W-I-N-S.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. In our income guidelines, we are 185% above poverty guidelines. So for a family of four, that's just shy of $45,000 a year. So that's a pretty generous income, especially maybe if one parent is staying home with the children, maybe one parent works. And that income goes up, you know, per family member. If you are pregnant, that unborn child is counted as part of your family size.
Okay.
So a lot of people will qualify when they become pregnant, or after maybe the baby's born and mom isn't working. That's also another time where families qualify because they don't have that income coming in, and we can look at the month's income, you know, to make them eligible for the program. But what we really want to push is that families come to WIC and they stay with WIC until the child's about 5 years old, because we do see a lot of families leave us after a year, and that makes us sad. We would like the kids to stay on the program until they are five, because there's a lot of good advice and nutrition that we can help with until they do reach the fifth birthday.
Well, Carrie, that's a great update on WIC, and thanks for all the information.
Thank you.
It was great to meet you here.
You too. Thank you.
Well, stay tuned. We have a health tip for you today.
Hello, my name is Amy Prezapora, the breast care coordinator at Women's Diagnostic Imaging Center, Meadville Medical Center, with your health tip of the day. Just reminding women age 40 and over to do clinical breast exam once a month, see your doctor once a year for a clinical breast exam, and have a yearly mammogram starting at age 40. Thank you, and this is your health tip of the day.
Thanks for the health tip. We appreciate those. Okay, part two today, Erie Home for Children and Adults. Let me introduce Chuck Walczak. Chuck, we go back a long, long time.
We do.
So let me ask you to introduce what the program's all about and the folks you brought with you today.
Great, great. So Erie Homes for Children and Adults, we refer to us as EHCA. I have with me two of my colleagues. I have Melissa Love, who is the Director of Services here in the Meadville area. In a moment, I have her share what we do here in Meadville. Most of our services are concentrated in the Erie area, but we do have a big presence here in Meadville as well. And Jonathan Reeling here, he is our Vice President of Marketing, Communication, and a few other things. We all wear a lot of hats at Erie Homes. Let me give you a nutshell of what we're about. We are an agency that services folks with intellectual disabilities. We take care of approximately 400 individuals on a daily basis in a variety of programs. Probably the one most people are familiar with is our residential program. We take care, we have 100 folks that live in our homes. We have 20 homes that are scattered through Erie County, and we do have two in Titusville. These folks are of the highest acuity in terms of overall population that we service. Then we also have a very large community program, a rehabilitation program we call it, and Melissa will talk about what we do here in Meadville. We have over 200 people on a daily basis where we work with folks who have intellectual disabilities that are living at home or living with loved ones, and we help provide respite and do activities with these folks to help them have a rich and fulfilling life. And maybe that's where it should have started, is that our mission, which we're very proud of, is to provide the ability for folks with intellectual disabilities to live rich and fulfilling lives. Much like we're here having a normal conversation, it's something I think we, and again, in no fault of our own, we take for granted. The folks who have intellectual disabilities typically aren't able to do the things normally in life that we enjoy. Again, just kind of doing this, eating regularly, and all that type of stuff. Everything we do is to try to allow and provide the opportunities to these folks so that they can live as much of a normal, rich, fulfilling life as possible. Whether it's in the residential program when they live with us, whether it's in the rehabilitation program where we work with the families. The other programs we have is an adult training facility. It's in the it's up in Erie over on the west side. It's where folks can come and spend a day with us and do different activities, vocational activities, artistic activities. We do everything we can to provide something more in their lives than they would normally be able to enjoy.
Let me throw you a question, Chuck. I can remember back in the day when the state hospital system was very prevalent. Now that's changed an awful lot in recent times. But I'm sure I'm exaggerating, but you know, we'll just lock them up and throw away the key, and we won't have to worry about those folks anymore. Was that a good thing?
Well, that was actually a very dark and bad part of the history of intellectual disabilities, and you're correct. And there's a lot of documentation on what had happened in the past. We're the answer to bring what has been a less than positive way of taking care of these folks, to bringing them into, a normalized life. As you mentioned, just 20, 30 years ago, most folks that were born with an intellectual disability were put into an institution. And it wasn't so much lock away the key and all that type of thing, but these folks were very limited in what they could do on a daily basis, life functions, activities, and so forth. Thankfully, society, advocacy groups, and many others realized that this is just totally inappropriate and inhumane. And what happened was, and without getting into a big explanation, a system was created in the state of Pennsylvania called the waiver system, which was a new way to be able to pay and develop public-private arrangements such as our agency, where we work with the state to be able to accommodate these folks in situations that are less or not even institutionalized at all. If there were to be a one-word goal on what we're all trying to accomplish, the state, the advocacy groups, the families, it's integration. It's to bring these folks into the regular normalcy of life. But you're right, the institutions from behind, unfortunately, it was a different prevailing thought. And fortunately, again, there was a lot of breakthrough and public sentiment across the board that allows agencies such as ours to be able to do what we do.
There's contributions that every person can make to society, to their family, and to their friends, and so on. So, lock them up and throw away the key, that's not the answer, I don't think. I agree with you on that one.
Yeah, we're again, that's the goal, is to integrate folks into a normal daily living. When it comes down to it, and I know this is a crude metaphor, we're all in this together. You know, we've got, and if you want to use, a crude metaphor, we all got pretty good hands in life, if you want to look at it from that standpoint. These folks, unfortunately, didn't get so many good cards in their hands, and what we're doing is reinforcing the things that they didn't get and helping provide for that. Let me turn to Melissa, who, runs the program down here in Meadville, and talk about the types of things that we do for the folks in the Meadville area. Melissa?
We really have some incredible programs down here. We have Options, which is our community-based. It's an unlicensed program, and we really work hard at really getting our individuals out in the community, learning new skills, and really associating with their peers. So again, you know, community integration is so important to us, and we really stress that. We provide services in the home or in the community itself. We also offer 24-hour respite for families who might just need a break, whether it's just going out of town for a day or just really needing someone to step in and help care for their loved one. Those are the types of services that we have. We also offer life sharing through family living, which again is another fabulous program that we offer. Currently we have 20 individuals in our care, and seven of those reside right here in Crawford County.
Why don't you explain the life sharing model in of itself?
The life sharing model in itself gives individuals the opportunity to share their lives with a provider family that is not a biological relative. They have the opportunity to participate in a family, much like yours or mine, and it's not institutional. The big push right now in Pennsylvania is to get a lot of these folks out of state institutions, out of group homes, but to give them the opportunity to have normal, enriched lives that all of us do.
Melissa, would it be fair to say that in a family living situation, it's really, again, a non-biological family adopting or fostering an individual with an intellectual disability, and then we work to support that family to help them with all the challenges of doing so? And we believe that's one of the furthest levels of integration in terms of an opportunity for folks with intellectual disabilities. Not everybody can qualify, depending on their limitations. That's why some need to go to group homes. And let me just mention this. Erie Homes for Children and Adults is one of the few facilities in the state that can take care of intellectual disabled folks that have high complex medical conditions. Mm-hmm. We have a number of our homes that are oriented around a medical model where we provide nursing and therapies, respiratory, a whole lot of ancillary services, because these folks, beyond having an intellectual disability, have compromising medical conditions that are very challenging as well. There's maybe six or seven agencies in the state that can do this. And in fact, and on a further show, we'll discuss some opportunities that we're looking at to further build homes to accommodate folks that have these conditions. Because right now, and many people don't realize this, that there is a waiting list. There's a very long waiting list for people waiting for services that we and other agencies can provide. There is not enough capacity in the system. There are still 900 people approximately in institutions in the state of Pennsylvania that we are trying to get into better settings like ours. So again, in the future, we'll describe to you our project that we're working on. I think that everyone will find very exciting in that regard.
Listen, let me ask you, I'm hearing this for the first time, and how might a family, you know, qualify, or what kind of things would they have to go through to maybe be able to help?
That's a great question, and we really go through a strict criteria that we put each person through who is looking to do this type of providing. Our providers go through, we check their clearances. Anyone that's over 18 years of age, we go through that process.
We're talking about specifically about the family living arrangement.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. You know, many of our providers were actually former employees of Erie Homes, which is wonderful. You know, they're well aware of maybe the needs that someone may have. We do background searches. We do lots of interviews. We really strive very hard to make sure that we have a good match. It's very important that the individual and the individual's family are just as comfortable as the provider.
I'm hearing you talk, and I'm thinking to myself, well, maybe Jonathan, maybe this is something for you, but make the sales pitch to a family out there about why they might want to consider this, or why they might think this would be a good thing. And I'm thinking, okay, the kids have moved away, you know, the kids have grown up and moved away, and I'm kind of lonely now. Does that make sense?
Sure, and I mean, as Melissa said, I mean, what we do is a very special thing. It's not for everybody. We have a very caring staff. It's a very niche group to deal with. And, you know, Chuck has often said it's a first step to sainthood in some ways to open your door to these folks and say, hey, you know, I want you to be a part of our family. And anybody who's worked in the field, EHCA or any other service provider, you get to know this population that we deal with, get to know these folks. They become part of your family. Oftentimes you get them involved in your life whenever you maybe are just starting out and they're just starting out, and you get to see them hit all these milestones as they grow up, just like you do with your own children, and it becomes a part of you, and it becomes a further extension of you. So it's a very special thing to become involved with.
And Duane, if I can answer the question in a more global manner in terms of how folks get into an intellectual an ID agency such as ours, typically, it happens when in childhood. Most ID cases are children being born with an intellectual disability. We do see other people come into the system that have like a traumatic brain injury or some other neurological condition that would occur, you know, later in life. But most of the folks are at childhood, and what happens is the family then works through intermediaries that are placed throughout the state. In Erie, it's called ECCM, Erie County Care Management, and what they basically are is a quasi-state agency where the family would go and talk to social workers to be able to determine and ascertain the needs of their loved ones. From there, those social workers work with the agencies across the state like us that would then find what would be the best placement for these folks. Again, some of them have conditions that warrant going into a residential setting. Some of them are better serviced at home, some of them through a life-sharing arrangement. Just in general, across the state of Pennsylvania, so people can appreciate the magnitude of this, there's between 200 and 250 agencies that take care of intellectual disability folks. In Erie, in the Crawford area, there's about five or six, and you know, we're all excellent, quite frankly. We don't really look at ourselves as competitors. We look at ourselves as complementary agencies where truly the client comes first. If we can't serve someone's needs as they are because of capacity or for some other special reasons, we work with other agencies. The goal is to get the person to the right setting so they can live as best of a life as possible. So we're excited to be able to share with the audience here about what we do. It's been, you know, for the longest of times, we've kind of stayed intentionally under the radar, so to speak. We thought it was better in general for the whole process of taking care of these folks, but the wisdom has changed, and I think in a very great way. I think society has become much more embracing of people with all types of disabilities. And what we're trying to do now is create as much awareness as possible of what we do for these folks so that everyone can contribute. Now, it's our primary job as being agencies to do this, but really, society in general, everybody is in this together. So we really promote that. You see folks around that, you know, most of the time you can tell who these folks are. We encourage you to talk and say hello and engage. There's tons of volunteer opportunities. There's many fundraising things that we do. So everybody can become involved in this. And we really are trying to make that statement along with all of our counterparts throughout the state, really to take this to another level. So this is a great opportunity to be able to share this with everyone in the audience.
So where do you find the services here in Meadville? Location?
Usually it's through referrals through the county. But again, we have a great website that anyone can go on to. And a lot of it too is word of mouth. We really seem to have a very good, foothold in the community, and people know who we are. So we're very fortunate.
www.ehca.org. Go on there, and there's a ton of information. And again, we're one of many agencies, but we certainly advocate everyone that's out there in the field trying to do this type of work that we do. It's very much needed, and We're excited about the progress that we're making in society.
So Erie Home for Children and Adults. I'm going to lock that into my brain here. And yeah, you suggested, you know, and I think that's a great thing. We'll have more topics about this coming down the road.
Excellent.
So, thank you. Well, guys, thanks for being with us today.
Thank you.
Well,
thank you for your time.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Well, thanks to the folks from the Erie Home for Children and Adults. We appreciate them being with us today, and also Carrie from WIC. Important topics, and I'm glad that we were able to bring those to you today. Upcoming on our Medicine of Meadville show, we have the Ask the Expert series, and we've had some of those shows for you before, and we've got more coming this year. So I'm looking forward to that. Our series will continue on some medical topics and health-related topics, so stay tuned for those. We'll be working those in along with some interview shows coming along, and I think those are actually working out pretty well. We do have another interview show coming up. I believe our next topic is going to be about overdose. So a very important topic. If you see the news locally, that's a great concern, certainly here, not just around Meadville Medical Center, but all across the community. So stay tuned for that. So thank you for joining us today on Medicine in Meadville, and we'll talk to you next time.